Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will continue our inquiry into COVID-19 communication on public health information, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting Adam Statura, the Head of Policy and Communications for Age Scotland. Unfortunately, Danny Boyle has had to hand in his apologies from BMIS this morning. I welcome Gillian McElroy, Policy and Information Officer from Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland. Dr. Sally Witcher, OBE Chair on the Scottish Commission on Social Security, and Professor Jill Pell, Director of the Institute of Health and Wellbeing from the University of Glasgow. Welcome everybody and thank you for giving us your time this morning and also for all your written submissions. Murdo Fraser is running slightly late, but he should be with us within 10 minutes, so just to let the witnesses know that. Our inquiry has three aims and this session is focused on the second aim, which is to consider whether public health information about COVID-19 is accessible to and meets the needs of specific audiences going forward, including people in the shielding category and communities where there has been below average take-up on the vaccination. This session will be the final stakeholder evidence session before we hear from the Minister on Public Health and Women's Health and Sport next week on the 30th of June. We estimate this session will run up to 11 o'clock and each member will have approximately 14 minutes each to speak to the panel and to ask questions. And if you'd like to respond to any issue being discussed, please press R in the chat box and we will try and bring you in. I'm keen to ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to speak, but I apologise in advance. If time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members and witnesses in the interest of brevity. Yes, sorry, I'm just to clarify, Dr. Sally Witcher is attending in a personal capacity this morning as well. Can I invite witnesses to briefly introduce themselves, and if I could start with Adam, please.
Good morning. Thank you very much for the invitation here. So I'm Adam Statura. I'm the Head of Policy and Communications at Age Scotland. We're the national charity for older people over the age of 50. And at the very start of the pandemic, our national helpline became a very central national resource for older people to understand what the messaging was around COVID-19. And we were funded by the Scottish Government to scale that up. So we've had tens of thousands of calls from older people about COVID-19 and related measures since then, and lots of hopefully helpful information for this committee.
Adam, and can I bring in Gillian McElroy, please?
Yeah, good morning, and thank you for the invitation to give evidence to the committee this morning. I'm Gillian McElroy, and I'm the Policy and Information Officer at the Health and Social Care Alliance. The Alliance is the national third sector intermediary for a range of health and social care organisations, and we have a growing membership of over 3,000 national and local third sector organisations. We've heard from our members throughout the pandemic that communication, public health messaging has been limited and interrupted at all levels, and we look forward to exploring that further throughout this session.
Thank you very much, Gillian. And can I bring in Dr. Sally Witcher, please?
Thank you very much, and good morning, convener. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you this morning. I first need to get absolutely clear. I am not here in the capacity of Chair of the Scottish Commission on Social Security. I resigned from that role a few weeks ago precisely because I was concerned that there may be some confusion about what I say in a personal capacity on this matter and the important role of that committee, commission. So can we just be very clear? I'm here in a personal capacity as somebody with a 30 plus year track record of working in the equality, inclusion and human rights fields in senior roles as recently a former director of the Chief Executive of Inclusion Scotland, previously of the Child Poverty Action Group in academia, and also as a senior civil servant and holder of various public appointments. So I'm also somebody who myself was on the highest risk list until it was discontinued recently. I am at high risk myself. I'm not eligible for vaccine boosters or antivirals. My last booster was 8 months ago, and I have been basically in my house for 2.5 years without any prospect of leaving in the foreseeable future. And I have a lot to say about, as do an awful lot of other people out there, because I have been active on Twitter and have a lot of things to say on behalf of people who feel they're not being heard. The frustration of knowing that the tools exist and it is no longer, it isn't actually necessary for it to be this way, that it is possible to build a safe, inclusive new normal, and frustration and I have to say anger that those aren't being used. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Dr. Witcher, and apologies, that was my fault from the briefing that I had, but we do know that you're here in your personal capacity. Can I bring in Professor Jill Pell, please?
Good morning. I'm a professor of public health. I was a member of the Scottish Government Advisory Committee on COVID until it was disbanded, but my reason for being here today is because I led a study on the shielding strategy, and specifically whether it was effective in terms of protecting individuals, but also whether it had a role to play in terms of protecting health service demand.
That's great. Thank you very much. I'll now turn to questions. And if I may start to ask the first question, if I can. And I'll start, if I can, with some of the concerns which were raised in the written submissions by yourself, Dr. Sally, which, and also the Alliance Scotland, in relation to clinically vulnerable. And I personally think it's really concerning that after what we've all faced over the odd past 2 years, that the clinically vulnerable groups who have very valid fears of COVID infection are now feeling that they could be faced with hostility from the general public in some places. So I found that really alarming to read the written report. First, I'd like to ask Dr. Sally Witcher, what in your view would an inclusive new normal look like?
Thank you very much. And clearly the whole debate around vaccination and masking has become pretty toxic. And what I've tried to do, because I could see possibilities of other things that could be done, was to think about, well, what could be done that doesn't actually require action from the general public? And there are a number of things that could be done that would have a real, there's no magic bullet here. Vaccine is a game changer, it's not a game winner for all time. So we need to think more broadly than that. And we need to understand that what makes people vulnerable is not just clinical risk, it's to do with the exposure as well. And there's much you can do around that. So the kinds of things that need to be seriously looked at, and they are up to a point, but not seriously, in my view. Clean air strategy. We take clean water for granted. We have now, one of the things that did come out of COVID that's positive and could be a Build Back Better initiative is around the technology around air filtration that removes virus from the air. HEPA air filters. There's also technology around air sterilization, which is all very new and is emerging. And, you know, this is another area of, if you like, almost like scientific inquiry that I think it's very important to give sufficient weight to. So that's a clear part of it. When it comes to the clinical side, it is about really making good use of the tools we have available. And I think one of the kind of areas that a lot of us are very confused about is we've been told that the reason for discontinuing the highest risk list is because that we now have vaccination and antiviral treatments, which we do, and they're good. But so why are people with high underlying clinical risk not eligible? We know vaccinations wane. We're not told anything about that. We know they don't always protect fully. So there's things around even existing clinical policy, which is very mysterious and raises a lot of questions. We'd love to know who's going to get the autumn booster. You know, this feels really desperate. We've got nothing to say. Our underlying clinical risk has in any way changed. So that's part of it. But it's also things like, you know, another real area for improvement has been around masks. We now understand about different kinds of masks. They do need to be fitted properly, FFP3s and so on. So do something about that, make them available. They're actually quite expensive. Things like that. If you're going to have a COVID safety signage scheme where premises can put things in their windows, well, build that, build, make that legally enforceable in the way they have in Belgium. So part of environmental health standards. So, you know, there's a lot you can be doing around the law. We've had, you know, people are increasingly getting tuned into the fact they've already got lots of rights, actually, as to unpaid carers with, under the Equality Act, which are things like reasonable adjustments. But the messaging we got and still are getting from the CMO around, you know, why not have a little chat with your employer if you're a bit worried about going back to work? Actually, the message is, you've got rights. You have got rights. And if it's not respected, that is disability discrimination under the law. But there's also kind of laws around hate crime, clean air. There is stuff on, you know, building regulations. You know, it's wide ranging, and nothing is being done to promote that. And we have, and it isn't, you know, sometimes you're going to need to update it. We need to rethink these things, because what the, what equality meant, the meaning of equality. We've got new equality groups now, new drivers. We need to have a completely different mindset now. You know, factor it into the review, the national performance outcomes. So that's what I'm. That's my case, basically. We need to think much more widely. If we used all those tools, as we could and as we should, then we could build an inclusive, safe, inclusive new normal. It isn't about some people having freedom at other people's expense, or some people being restricted and all that other people can have freedom. It's about everybody being able to have maximum freedom and avoid the risk to everybody of long COVID. Because that, again, is just simply not being communicated. It isn't just about our risk as people who are at clinical risk. It's about everybody's risk. And the numbers there are rocketing. And this is a real crisis, which is going to have a big impact on the economy, on education, as well as on people's lives and children's life chances.
Thank you very much. I totally agree. And I think, as you've said it from the last two odd years, there's been no guidebook on anywhere across the world on how we deal with this pandemic, or how, as we emerge into the new normal as such. It was interesting that you mentioned Belgium there, because I think that one of the things that we can look at is we can learn a lot from how other countries across the world are dealing, emerging from COVID as well, because I think, as I said, there's no guidebook, so I think there's lots of lessons to be learned. Dr. Witcher, is there any other countries that you feel are probably a bit more progressive, or that we could be learning from? I know that you mentioned Belgium, but that are getting it right as they emerge from COVID?
I think, you know, you're absolutely right to say this is, that people are dealing with this in very different ways. And the thing is, it's developing the whole time. We're really not, the pandemic isn't over. It's still evolving. We're in a different stage now, but we're not in recovery. And so we do need to look widely and learn where we can. I am aware, I am not going to give you chapter and verse now, because I don't have the research to hand, and I want what I say to be evidence-based. But I would be very happy to come back to you with my thoughts and research on that, because I do think there's learning. And even just what you pick up in sort of mainstream media, you can see that other countries have, you know, they have different challenges as well, and different kind of cultural attitudes, different kinds of leadership, and different starting points and understandings about viruses of these kinds as well. So we maybe need to be a little cautious when drawing direct comparisons, but I do think there's an enormous amount of learning out there which could be incredibly helpful, because I think we all want to build back better, including the Scottish Government, absolutely. And it's just about how we can constructively work together to make that happen within the very real constraints that I know governments experience of multiple kinds.
Thank you. That's really interesting. I might open it up to the other witnesses if I can, and just ask their views and how can the needs of the high-risk individuals be better communicated to the general public as we go on to the next stage of COVID? I don't know if anyone just wants to raise their hands, because I can see you on the screen. We can bring you in. Adam?
Thank you. I think there is a very interesting piece in all of this of the last 2.5 years, where we could have been in a position where we're sort of looking to, you know, segment the public into, you know, who needs extra help and who then doesn't at a certain point, and that's quite a dangerous place. What I don't mean is that people shouldn't be getting all the support they need. Thinking once people feel that they've got the kind of freedom that they feel that someone else is stopping them getting their maximum freedom, as Dr. Witcher has slightly suggested. And I think part of this is looking at how sort of the communication is talks about our whole country, about what everybody needs, and actually not finding in a position where we have find ourselves in a position where we have, you know, those the highest clinical risk, those who are unpaid carers, feeling that they're in the wind, feeling that they are left behind as sort of the world is moving on, and not getting the kind of the maximum support. And I think actually that, in a sense, in terms of that communication, you can get the negative communication from people who are really needing support and feel they need support, whether or not, you know, sometimes the clinical advice is that, okay, broadly speaking, you might be okay now, but actually individuals will have a different view on that because they'll know their health and they'll know their circumstances better than ever. I know lots of older people who are still shielding despite not being necessarily clinically at risk because they're terrified of getting COVID. They want to make sure that they are as healthy as possible, and they don't want to pass on to anyone else in their life who might be at high clinical risk. So I think in terms of that communication part is trying to avoid a situation where those who do need support are then negatively communicating about their experiences, and then it becomes a haves and haves not part. And I think this is a really important part for the health service and for the Scottish Government to address, is that making sure folks are getting everything they possibly need so we don't have that sort of disparity of experiences.
Thank you, Adam. Can I bring in Gillian McElroy, please?
Thank you. And I think to begin, we would agree with many of the points that Dr. Witcher and Adam have made. I think just to build on that and add some broader considerations, the Alliance, we state strongly for an equality and human rights-based approach. So that includes, you know, empowering people to know that they have rights, to claim them, and to know that they have accessible routes to remedy and redress if those rights are not respected, protected and fulfilled. And I think part of the broader communication needs to really highlight that. I think as well, in terms of an equality and human rights-based approach, public bodies need to be carrying out human rights and equality impact assessments at the earliest opportunity, and in consultation with people with lived experience to really understand those intersectional impacts of COVID and the pandemic and the potential impacts of decision-making on people's everyday lives. And I think, as you've sort of touched on, there is a need for ongoing research and investment to fully understand, you know, the impacts of COVID. I think the other thing I would add is that something we've heard from members is there's a lack of understanding of the risks of COVID infection and the scale and severity of long COVID. And efforts are really needed to improve that understanding and knowledge of long COVID in the community. We recently commissioned research at the Alliance on accessing social support for long COVID. And one of the key themes from that research was issues with public awareness around long COVID and the effect it can have on people. So I think there's something in there about sort of a national long COVID communications campaign to really educate the public around that and the effect that it can have on people, and considering that as part of the inclusive new normal as we move forward. And I think just to touch on your question about how the needs of sort of higher risk individuals can be better communicated to the general public, I think there's something in there about moving away from the sort of binary positions that our members have perceived about COVID being before and after restrictions and before and after lockdown. It's something that our members have felt within the public messaging, and I think that needs to change at all levels, you know, in national and local public health messaging and in the media, to really increase that public awareness of the risks of COVID and the impact it can have on people and unpaid carers.
Thank you, Gillian. That's really helpful. I'm going to move on to Murdo Fraser, who has joined us this morning. Good morning.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My apologies to you and colleagues and to witnesses for my late arrival, which is because my usual method of transport coming by train was not available, and I was battling with Highland Show traffic to get in. But good morning to you all. I'd like to ask about the issue of targeting of communications, because one thing the committee's heard from previous witnesses is that there's not a one-size-fits-all approach to public health messaging that meets the needs of all. And if we segment the population, there are various minority groups. That includes older people, those in ethnic minorities, those in higher risk groups, for whom the messaging might need to be different for that of the general population. So I'll maybe start with Adam on this, but do you think that COVID public health messaging was adequately targeted to different groups? And if not, what more needs to be done in future to try and fix this?
I'd say it's a good question. I would say at the beginning of the pandemic, at the beginning or the height of the severity of this virus, that the broad national do all messaging, this really simple stuff, was good. That it was sort of undertaken on channels which were accessible to the vast majority of people. Television broadcasting, I think, was a particularly good one. And where there were, you know, advertising campaigns, because the messaging was simple. I think this is a really important part. The messaging at that time was very, very simple. What was very interesting at the time in terms of older people in general and this experience for our national helpline was that while there was very simple messaging coming from First Minister, Chief Medical Officer, you know, clinical directors and others, our national helpline would immediately get phone calls asking for further clarity on what that meant in their particular circumstances. So I do X or Y, can I do this? I care for whoever, can I do this? Go to stay at home, but my mother lives a couple of, you know, local authorities away, can I still go there? And actually, you know, there's lots of realizing at this point that people's lives are very complex and that the simple messaging, while it's important, will raise other things. So in terms of that communication of it and the channels, I think at the beginning it was pretty good. There was also at the same time there was no other news, was there? The only game in town was, you know, COVID news, what our national protections were. So that made life very, very straightforward. As soon as things started to change and language changed, I think we encountered more difficulties from folks. And let's look at, let's say, older people from ethnic minorities where English isn't their first language, who are then at home or without the support networks that they might have had, whether it's through community clubs and groups or through their own family to help them to better understand what that was, the sort of translation, in a sense, in the best way they possibly can from English into it. That might not have been as available to them as it could have been. And I think this is an ongoing challenge that we have with making sure that everybody understands what the messaging is. But again, going back one step, and I won't dwell on this too long, but as soon as the messaging about COVID became a bit more complex, the scale of inquiries to our national helpline increased massively. It became much harder to work out what that meant in that circumstance, you know. And even, you know, looking again, 500,000 over 60s in Scotland, we estimate, don't use the internet. You know, there's a hell of a lot of people that also who are online don't use it particularly well, in a sense that aren't the most competent at everything. So burying things away in websites just because you can say, you know, go to NHS Inform or whatever, actually might be a harder task for many than you might think if you're sort of very sort of digitally native. So as soon as we start burying information online onto websites, or I mean, look, you could do any number of investigations into, let's say, you know, the websites of GP surgeries and a variety of different kind of quality of the information that's on there, or homepages that are very cluttered. So people are looking for information and just finding bits all over the place. You know, so I think it's when the message is simple, I think it was effective. As soon as we started to have a bit more complex messaging, people found it a lot harder to understand what that was. And as soon as we stopped investing massively in broadcast and in non-digital means, that it became harder for folks to really understand and know where to go to get the right advice and the right information.
Yeah, thanks very much for that answer. And I'm sure all the MSPs here would be very familiar with the situation where we were being bombarded with queries from constituents asking, you know, in these circumstances, can I do X, Y, Z? And we weren't equipped to answer those questions either. And for us, trying to get answers was actually a very difficult and time-consuming process. I think Jill Pell wants to come in, and then Sally Witcher.
So on the specific question of targeting, at the beginning of the pandemic, we had 2% of the population that were categorised as extremely clinically extremely vulnerable and told to shield. But there was another 27% of the population that were in this moderate risk group who were just advised to be more diligent and following general guidance. But what we found when we looked at the data was that, yes, the shielded group were at much higher risk in spite of shielding. They were still 18 times more likely to be hospitalised for COVID, 49 times more likely to die from it. But this moderate risk group were actually also at much higher risk than the low risk category. So, and they were still, you know, 7 times more likely to end up in hospital COVID, 26 times more likely to die from it. And they weren't getting the same targeted message as the shielded group. And because they were so much larger in number, they were actually contributing to far more of the hospitalizations and the deaths in the general population. So I think that's a group that we need to consider. And that group's predominantly people who just happen to be 70 plus years in age and don't have the same levels of morbidity that are required to get into the shielding group.
Okay, thank you. Sally Witcher?
The first thing to say is that, yeah, of course, there's it's important to have clearly segmented communication and understand what people want to know, have what questions they have, and how to answer them in ways that are going to be accessible to them. It's also important, though, to think about the fact that most people will access the general public messaging, and it's about how that lands as well. And one of the kind of challenges around that is that messages that will land with one bunch of people in one way will land with another bunch in a very different way. So if somebody says, as the First Minister did, when the mask mandate was removed, I'm confident that most people will continue to wear masks and remind to protect the vulnerable, what gets heard is, we're not confident. we're not, as people on the sharp end, and it only takes one. Our freedom is contingent on other people having the goodwill to protect us, which is not about rights, it's not about equal citizenship. So there's some things here about the fact that, you know, people mostly will go with what the general stuff is. Second thing, though, when it comes to targeting, you actually did a rather good job in some ways in establishing, well, the government did, a channel with people with high underlying clinical risk in the form of their chief medical officer's letter, which they've now discontinued. And that was actually quite an effective way. But the key thing is, if audiences are very diverse, you must have multiple communication channels, and all of them need to be accessible. That was a good one, because it's one that a lot of people could access. Not everybody, but some, a large proportion of that target audience. But it didn't tell us things we wanted to know. So it's one thing to kind of get your targeted communication channel right. But if you haven't got the information, if you're not using it to communicate what people want to know, it kind of misses the point. And so telling us about where to go if we need a little bit of support to build our confidence to adjust to going back to normal was not the point. The point was we were very anxious because we hadn't been given the information that enabled us to feel safe. Because what there was, the evidence that was about the reason for discontinuing the higher risk list was inaccessible, out of date, as it said. It was quite clear from what it said itself, wasn't robust, and only dealt with the question of vaccine vaccine protection. Nothing on waning vaccine protection, nothing on a whole manner of other things that people wanted to know. People want to know about Evershell, people want to know about autumn boosters. So there's a kind of number of things here. One is get your general comms right and make sure that it lands correctly with everybody. One is if you establish good channels and then make use of them in ways that are going to be effective and answer people's questions. And probably the biggest point I would want to make is if you really want to reach segmented, you know, specific groups in ways that are going to be effective. They're going to tell them what they need to know. Then why not go and ask them, involve them in the development of communication strategies? They will tell you how this will land. They will tell you whether it answers their questions. You know, this is something governments has done a lot around setting up little groups. You know, people have policy panels like Inclusion Scotland on social care support. There was the core group for the charter, social security charter. There are models out there. You could be doing this. The government could be doing this. I don't know why it isn't. And the thing about communication is it's two-way. It's not just we tell you what we know, what we don't know, what you should do. It's kind of, well, what is it you need to know? What are your questions? What are your concerns? And then we'll tell you what we know, what our advice would be. And if you only do the top-down, you know, adult to child type model, you know, government as parent, it isn't going to work. And people are not children, they're adults. And whatever their views about this situation, it doesn't mean, you know, people are not stupid. They can spot mixed messages a mile off. And that's what you need to be ensuring. So being told, well, you know, you've got to keep 1 meter distance now in this setting, but it's 2 meters over here and over here, it doesn't matter at all. You know, you can only be 3 people over here in this situation, but it's perfectly fine for a great load of people in that one. People can work that out. And that isn't just about targeting, it's about making it consistent and clear. You've got very diverse people here in very diverse situations, even within one segmented audience. You've got to get it consistent. You've got to get it landing right.
Thanks very much. I think we hear you loud and clear, Dr. Witcher. Gillian McElroy wants to come in.
Yep, thank you. It was just to add a few points from the perspective of the Alliance, which I think will, you know, echo and chime with many of the points that have gone before. Alliance members have shared that public health messaging, you know, has been variable both at national and local levels throughout the pandemic. And while some people have found the government guidelines useful and there have been those pockets of good practice, I think many others have found the change in guidelines and availability and services really quite difficult to follow, which can lead to confusion and a lack of clarity around the guidance. And of course, that has a direct impact on people's health and wellbeing, but also their ability to access health and social care services. I think a key issue, which has already been touched on, but is that lack of, you know, person-centred information. So people have reported receiving blanket information provision, which can be too general and too ambiguous and doesn't consider the needs of different and specific population groups. And I think as well the issue of accessible information is really key. And we know that there's been a lack of COVID information provision in a range of accessible and multiple formats, so including alternative languages or community languages, things like Braille, easy read, things as basic as large print. So it really needs to have that sort of universal and inclusive approach to ensure people are fully informed on an equitable basis. We've also heard about specific issues for autistic people in terms of that ambiguous information. Often written communication can be too ambiguous and lacking clarity on key information. So I think that tailored and person-centred approach is really needed, both to increase understanding of the restrictions and what was going on during COVID, but also in terms of accessing health and social care services and working through health and social care interactions. But I think the key takeaways and learnings that we would take away is the need for making information publicly available in multiple formats, and also having those multiple formats published on a timely basis, and where possible, having them made available at the same time as mainstream communication And as Dr. Witcher had mentioned, involving relevant experts, including people with lived experience, at the earliest opportunity.
Thanks to you all for that answer. I've just got one follow-up briefly, and maybe go back to Adam Strakura on this. One of the messages the committee's had is that social media could be used more effectively in terms of targeting particular audiences. But Adam, you said that 500,000 over 60s don't have access to the internet. So interested to get your perspective on how effective social media would be in reaching groups, particularly older people. We can't hear you at the moment.
There we go. I'll just take myself off mute. Again, another good question. Look, social media's got a massively important part to play in a lot of this, but yeah, there's a lot of people, not just older people who aren't online, a lot of people who aren't comfortable being online, a lot of people who aren't online every minute of the day that yourself and I, Mr. Fraser, might be if we've got our mobile phone in our pocket or busy on Twitter or Facebook or whatever. So it has, I think, a really good place to play, but it shouldn't be the primary route for this. And Dr. Witcher has alluded to, within every single group, there are also segments within those groups, which is quite hard. So all these kind of targeting is actually quite tricky, and not everybody is on a list somewhere. Social media is going to be important. I think actually with a lot of the kind of COVID messaging from Scottish Government, from NHS and from others, the use of social media was pretty good. You know, I think when folks were getting it, you know, there were simple messages, there were, you know, accessible kind of videos, there were things that were kind of short enough and take you and direct you to a lot of the right places. I think there's a lot of good things that happened there. But an over-reliance on a digital kind of first or sort of digital primacy route, I don't think, in a not just a national crisis, but in terms of including all of our residents and citizens in the right information, isn't necessarily right. And again, you know, there's lots of people said earlier on that while they might be digitally connected, aren't that confident in it or don't trust it that much, or are worried about the wrong news in social media, your sort of your fake news, the disinformation part, or people that can kind of be taken in by sort of feel that they're credible sources, but they really aren't, whether it was about kind of the effectiveness of vaccines or other things, which we would, you know, as a national charity, we're just trying to articulate and advertise what kind of the NHS and what the Scottish Government were saying on all of these things, as in terms of what we thought was the most responsible thing to do. So it is important, but yeah, but just broadcast was so important, newspapers were so important, radio was so important. I think that having, you know, BSL, you know, interpreters on TV with the First Minister and anyone else doing it was a great thing, too, the right thing. But all of these things are going to be expensive with public health messaging. So social media is seen as the cheap and easy way and the quickest way. Yeah, sure, it might be, but getting it right is going to be very intense and quite expensive. But that's probably necessary.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much.
Alex Riley, can I bring you in, please?
Thank you. Yeah, convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I ask maybe in terms of where we're at today, right now, I certainly know more people this week with COVID than I've known at any point throughout the pandemic. So we seem to have COVID that is, the numbers are increasing. I saw calls this morning for all over 50s to be vaccinated. So in terms of where we're at today, do you think that there's a greater understanding of COVID and the measures that are in place? Or do you think that perhaps people have reached a point where it's a bit like they think, well, it's a bit like having the flu? And despite the fact that there's these other variants, and we're starting to see across the world other variants spread, are you relaxed with where we're at, or do you think that we actually need to have some kind of review and look at what messaging needs to go out there to support people in the here and now? And are you hearing concerns come across from your organisations about the current up-to-date position. Perhaps I can start with Adam.
Well, look, thanks for that question, or being brought in first. I was maybe hoping to ride in the coattails of others on my answer, but you mentioned that, you know, restrictions or whatever. There are no real restrictions, are there, for most people? You know, the general view is that it's sort of normality, you know, in terms of what we need to do or what we're mandated to do or what we're being asked to protect ourselves and others is largely there. The masks are sort of the last element of that. And while there is that sort of understanding that masks should be used, you know, very few people actually do. Even on, you know, public transport, other places, this is, you know, people of all ages actually. That there isn't a sort of a national vaccination program still in effect. There are the latest dose will be available to some people, but not everybody. So the vast majority of folks will not think that it's necessary or for them. Therefore, things have kind of moved on. Folks are going on holiday abroad again. You know, there are, you're right. There, I'm aware of more people than I ever have who have had COVID recently or have it now. The severity of that might be a lot sort of less than it had been, you know, 2 years ago. We're hearing less of people being in hospital for it, so maybe folks are feeling that it's we're in a better place. But then there comes new stories about new variants, and I think, and this is my thought on this, is that we hear very little now from older people through our helpline and others about COVID-related things. The challenges are about how do you kind of get life restarted, but also the big fears about them in terms of COVID as the virus, but what the kind of challenges they're facing in terms of their own life, the loneliness and isolation, the mental health challenges, the physical health challenges, the lack of access to medical and health services, to other social settings. So, like, for a lot of people, that life has kind of moved on to try and get things back to their own normal, but it's a lot harder than it will be. But with new variants happening, there are some anxiety about what happens next. How quickly can we turn things back on if we need to? And actually looking ahead to, say, the winter time or kind of, you know, autumn, winter and beyond, what might happen there, I think will start to become more of a concern for people over time as new variants start to develop. And look, we don't know a lot about the future, but are we as a nation ready to and able to protect people as we have in the past, as quickly and effectively as we have now that essentially all the restrictions have been dropped?
Okay. Gillian McElroy.
Yep, thank you. I think reflecting on your question, I think there is a need for better understanding of, you know, the continued risks of COVID to everyone. I touched on it earlier, but I think certainly amongst our members, there is this perception that the public messaging is very, very binary and it's this before and after restrictions. And I think that really needs to change to increase that public awareness. You know, for many people, it's the view that COVID is finished, COVID is over, but we know that's not the case for huge numbers of people, for everyone. So we really need to, I think about that in our public messaging and reflect it. I think there's also somewhat confusing messaging. We've got the, you know, the Scottish Government COVID Sense campaign, but I'm not sure how clear that is to people when, you know, restrictions have effectively finished, that people are still being told to consider COVID Sense. I'm not sure how clear that is to the general public, what that means for themselves and what that means for people who are at high clinical risk and for unpaid carers. I think in terms of your question, I think there's, you know, still that need for awareness of the real risks of COVID as we continue today.
Okay, and Dr. Witcher.
Thank you. I think what's happening now is we've kind of hit crunch time where the narrative that we're in recovery, it's over, it's back to normal, hits head on the reality that it isn't. And it's a reality that is present in a lot of people's lives, as you rightly say. You know, the huge numbers of people now getting infected, including people reinfected and people who have not been infected before. And so what's happened here is I think we're seeing almost like is a sort of screeching of brakes as we need to do a U-turn from that messaging and from that that kind of presentation of a reality that it's fine, we can move forwards now back to the old normal, and almost like going back into an acknowledgement that we now need to do. So you know, people are kind of understandably very confused about this. The messaging is mixed. It was only over a few days I was looking at it. So on the one hand, we've got a lot of experts arguing that, in fact, the entire population should be offered a booster, that long COVID is rising, that this is a new variant, it's highly transmissible, it looks like it may settle in the lungs, which could be more serious. Herd immunity is probably a myth, and so a lot of warnings. But then we have people going, it's mild, it's not, you know, compared to all the others, it's not a problem. There's very few people really now at clinical risk because of the vaccine, which, by the way, is waning, and we don't really know much about that, but hey, move on. Don't panic, no need for restrictions. Now, so first off, can I issue a general plea? Can we stop calling them restrictions, please? These are not restrictions, they're protections. They're what protect people's freedom. They don't restrict it. And that goes not just for people at high clinical risk, it goes for the population in general. And so I think that's where we are now. And what I would ask is for the Scottish Government to exercise some COVID sense here, please. And respond, follow the science about where we are, and exercise some leadership here around not causing us to spin over the edge of a cliff because we haven't negotiated that change of tack with the skill and that we need to, because the consequences of that basically, if we don't get the messaging right now, the Scottish Government doesn't get the policy right, then we are looking at a very serious situation. And if you think people are disengaging and distrustful, perhaps it's because they're trying to make sense of those extremely mixed messages. So I do think there's a really important role here for the Scottish Government. I still believe that the Scottish Government wants to do the right thing, wants to build back better. And I just, you know, previous person who asked a question, Murdo Fraser, said that I was being heard loud and clear. Well, I don't think a lot of people feel that they are being heard loud and clear. And it would be brilliant if that could now happen, because there's a lot of very worried people out there. Thank you very much.
OK, thank you. And Professor Pell?
So there are effectively four prongs to what we can do, and we've removed three of them. So as Adam already mentioned, we've taken away the non-pharmaceutical interventions, the requirement for social distancing, the mandatory need for facial coverings, etc. We've also removed access to mass testing, which we need to acknowledge. And we've also removed the idea of having a shielding list, a supported shielding list. So we're left solely with vaccination, really. Vaccination, it does reduce transmission, it does reduce severity, but nonetheless, cases are going up, as you say. And in some people, those cases will result in adverse outcomes, you know, hospitalisation, death, long COVID and so on. And there's always a threat of new variants. So I think we do need to remain diligent and particularly think about whether we need to reconsider access to testing if the rise in cases justifies it, because it's very difficult for people at the moment, even if they want to be good citizens, to identify they have infection and take action and so on. So I think we do need to watch the situation closely and be willing to respond to it.
OK, thank you. And in terms of the question around vaccination, as I say, I saw some public health experts call for all over 50s to get the booster coming into this year's winter. Is your view, Professor Pell, that there is enough information available to us? Have the public got the confidence? Vaccine take-up was good, despite, I know, there are specific areas, but by and large, it was really good. But I worry for the future if we have a vaccine for the booster for all over 50s, that the uptake won't be as high. What's your views on that?
Well, first, as I say, we're reliant on vaccination. We've removed the other options, so therefore we have to make sure it's delivered comprehensively and regularly with boosters. So absolutely. Uptake, as you say, has been good. But also I think there's always been good confidence in the Scottish population compared to, you know, south of the border in the US. You've maintained that really well in the Scottish government. And I think if people understand, and they do so far, and if you continue to communicate that by getting vaccinated, they could potentially avoid these other, you know, other lockdowns, other restrictions and so on, that I think that would motivate them to continue to have high uptake with vaccination rates.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in John Mason, please?
Thanks so much, Convener. And, we've talked quite a lot about communication already, and I kind of wanted to continue that into the area of communication of uncertainty. We've had some advice from some of the kind of scientific community and so on that we should be very open about uncertainty, and that increases transparency and that increases trust. But given that we've already accepted that actually getting simple messages across to all the different languages and all the different groups in society is quite difficult, I just wonder, is it realistic when there is uncertainty? And yet there obviously is. And one example was a pregnant woman at the beginning of the vaccination programme, where I think they had not been tested on pregnant women, and therefore there couldn't be a decision made. So it was publicly said that would have to wait. But the kind of message a lot of people took up was vaccines are dangerous for pregnant women. So I just wonder if any of you could comment on this idea of how do we deal with uncertainty, and maybe Professor Pell could start on that one.
So the public trust in Scotland has been much, much higher through the whole pandemic than it has in some other countries. And part of that's been because communication coming from Scottish Government has been honest. So I think it's been clearly explained to them what we know and what we don't know and what we're doing and why we're doing it. And I think it's when politicians and policymakers try to pretend they know more than they do that people see completely through that and stop trusting you. So I think you should be open and honest with people. I mean, not to the extent of scaremongering, but I think you gain much more trust and respect, and more importantly, much more compliance. People are much more likely to do what you're asking them to do if they think you're being honest with them in the communication and justifying why you're asking them to take certain actions. And the evidence bears that out.
You don't think it increases confusion?
No, confusion comes around how you communicate. You can communicate uncertainty in a way that's clear. I mean, you can communicate uncertainty in a way that's unclear. I mean, the ability to communicate clearly has to be separated from whether you're being open and honest or not.
Okay, that's a good answer. I think I might quote you on that. Could I come to Gillian McIlroy? Because I think the Alliance talked about we need more communication around long COVID. And I just wonder if we're in the same kind of place as we were, you know, with vaccination for pregnant women, in that there's so much uncertainty around long COVID. Is this really the time to be doing a communication campaign?
Yes, I think there's a growing evidence base around long COVID. And I think, you know, the impact of long COVID, I think it's clear amongst those that have been impacted. I think if we can start communicating that just now, when people have been really severely impacted for the past 2 years, I think there's no reason to sort of delay that. But I think it goes back to the points about that clear messaging is really important.
Okay, even if we don't know and we're honest with people, are you agreeing with the previous comment that if we are uncertain about certain things, we should just be honest with people about that?
I think there's evidence out there about the scale and severity of long COVID, and I think that can be harnessed in communicating. I acknowledge that there are, you know, uncertainties, but I think starting with what we do have, that can be communicated to raise public understanding.
Okay, and maybe Dr. Witcher?
Quite a lot of evidence these days around long COVID. I mean, I've certainly seen figures of there being something like 2 million people in the UK. There are figures around increases, and I would strongly advise that this is now a relevant indicator to include alongside hospitalisation and death rates, because it is a growing problem. And I think it's also something that employers and businesses are picking up on. There has been recent coverage of some confusion about whether people live with long COVID were covered by the Equality Act, and many of them will be, I suspect, depends on the definition and whether they meet it of a disabled person. So there is a lot to be done here, but this is the next phase of the pandemic, I think, as well. This is like a new feature arising, and there really is. There are organisations out there like Long COVID Scotland, Long COVID Kids Scotland, which have got a lot of data, a lot of information, and a lot of lived experience to contribute as well. I think we need to. It's worth kind of recognising that now. This is definitely happening. We do have information. Yes, this is an evolving picture. It's been like that throughout. I certainly agree with what Professor Powell said about you can be very clear about communicating that it's not yet clear, but you do need to communicate that and also be very wary of communicating certainty where you're not. But I think we do actually have some things that could be communicated around long COVID now, which are pretty clear, and the scale of risk is pretty clear, particularly with things around the scale of reinfection. And so on. This is an ongoing issue. It isn't a kind of, get it once, it's over and done with. This is not herd immunity. And each time you get it, there's risks of long-term damage to brain, to heart, to all kinds of organs, and they can be life-changing.
Okay, I mean, that's helpful. I think I've got a consistent message from all the witnesses so far, so that's good. I'll move on to, if I can stick with you, maybe Dr. Witcher. You've emphasised the use of words, and I fully accept that words are really, really important. I'm a little bit wary of you're saying that we should only use the word protection, we shouldn't use the word restriction, because it strikes me it's both. And if we just use protection, I just wonder if people would say, well, you're just putting a spin on it, because the reality is my life is being restricted. I can't go and visit my friends in London or whatever it might be. So, you know, I think my suggestion to you would be, surely we should use the words both protection and restriction, to be honest with people. But I'm also interested, you seem to be critical in your evidence of the use of the word vulnerable. And I just wondered if you could expand on that, because vulnerable is a word we use, I have to say, in Parliament quite a lot, be it financially vulnerable or in a health context or in a whole variety of contexts. So maybe just around this use of words.
Yeah, I'll be delighted to. Thank you for the question. Yes, I mean, the thing I think is that there are some forms of protection which are restrictive. So lockdown, that's protection, but it is very restrictive of freedom. The challenge that arises when you're talking about things in terms of restriction that actually don't really restrict freedom at all. But in both cases, things that may in any way require action, they're restrictive in as much as they require action, but they don't necessarily limit freedom at all. And the reason for limiting freedom, if that's what you have to do, is in order to protect, not because you thoroughly enjoy restricting people's freedom. So there's something here about how communications are used in ways and what they communicate. So for us, and it's about where you're positioned as well, so for us, we would see what is portrayed as restrictions very often as being protections, just for us, but for other people as well. So this is what communication is about. It's about how things are understood. You could say that calling them restrictions is putting a spin on it too, to put a subject to your agenda. in terms of vulnerable, it isn't that the word is necessarily one you can't use. And a lot of people who are clinically at high risk use that word themselves. So it isn't that. It's about, for me, it's about understanding what creates vulnerability. And what I'm arguing is that being at high clinical risk itself isn't what necessarily makes you vulnerable. Because if you're in an environment which is safe, where the virus isn't being let rip, where the infection spread is being managed, and protections are in place, you're not vulnerable. So what actually makes a person vulnerable with high clinical risk is not the high clinical risk, it's the removal of protections, which may mean that they're not safe, or failure to install them in the first place with things like HEPA air filtration and so on.
Okay, that's helpful. I suspect we're more in agreement. No, I think we're more in agreement than maybe I thought we were at the beginning. So that's all very helpful. Thanks. Could I just move on to one other subject? I picked up, it was in the Alliance briefing submission that, you know, the idea of the third sector filling the gap. And I just wonder if that was a complaint. So maybe Gillian McElroy could come in, and then maybe Adam Stachura after that. You know, is that not the place for the third sector? I mean, the public sector is largely lumbering and bureaucratic, and there are always going to be gaps, and that is what I see the third sector as doing very well. So maybe you could just tell me if you think that that wasn't right, or what you were thinking on that.
Yep, I think there's a point here to be made about at the outset of the pandemic, you know, we heard from people whose social care packages, for example, were withdrawn or reduced with little or no notice. And I think in instances like that, the third sector really stepped in to help people and support people with issues such as those. But I think it's really about partnership working between public bodies, the Scottish Government, and third sector organisations and community groups to provide that support to people. I think in terms of, I don't think the role of the third sector is to fill the gap as such, but to be, you know, valued as equal delivery partners in that sort of care and support.
Okay, thanks. Adam Stachura, can you comment on that bit?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Mason. If you look back to sort of in terms of the COVID response from the third sector, it was able, and it still is in a lot of it, able to adapt a lot quicker, as you're suggesting, than the public sector to, you know, fill not just a gap, but a new gap. Like, we needed to do certain things. Age Scotland had a national helpline. We had to scale that up from 80 calls a day to take 1,000 calls a day because there was no other resource for older people at the time. Supported well, and thankfully by the Scottish government to do that, and those look at all the kind of the, you know, the support for those who are put on shielding lists. That lots of this was uptaken by third sector organisations, and were able to adapt at a, you know, breakneck speed and deliver what was required for a long period of time. And I think this is why it's really important, because you're thinking about trust and we're looking at communication. It's about organisations that are also trusted, that have networks, that have audiences, that have sort of clients that they work with and work for on a regular basis. So there is, I think it's been a benefit of our country to be able to have a third sector that has been able to support people incredibly well. It's precarious though. I mean, if you look at it, if in terms of like a lot of charities and third sector organisations had financially a very difficult time going into and through this pandemic, which we're still in, where there is a reliance on them to undertake extraordinary tasks, that they're able to be resourced to do that quickly. I think, you know, there's a lot of support I think that was given by, say, Scottish Government and other UK Government and other places for that. And I think that just demonstrates just how important a third sector in Scotland is and why it needs to be supported to be resilient. Because that's what we require as part of this crisis, and this won't be the only crisis that we'll face. I hope it is, but I'm sure it won't be. That we have a big network that is able to step in, but it's not been able to help everybody because we've got so many people in the country that are not on anyone's list.
Okay. Okay, that's very helpful. Thanks. That's great. Thanks, Gavina.
Thank you very much. Brian Whittle, would you like to come in, please?
Thank you, Kavina, and good morning to the panel. I just want to kind of wind back a little bit here. I think looking at, again, at communication, I think especially, you know, early on, I think the information we had evolved and changed. And for me personally, you know, obviously I'm not in a category that was vulnerable, but I found it difficult to follow sometimes and not quite sure how I should be in public or not, and then eventually not in public. Can I ask, I mean, did that have a disproportionate impact on those who were potentially the most vulnerable categories? Because, of course, the impact of COVID on those who are clinically vulnerable is much greater. So that uncertainty of information potentially was much greater. Can I just maybe get a wee bit of background on that? Can I start with Professor Pell, please?
I suspect I'm not the best person to answer this. I think Sally probably is better placed. But I think there are probably two issues. I think the high-risk group were having to deal with two separate sets of communications, the general advice that was going to everybody, but also the specific advice that was going to them. The volume of information they were getting was greater, the complexity of the information they were getting was greater, and then on top of that, there's our own individual circumstances, and as we've heard, all information is by definition generic, and it's how does it relate to me personally, but I think I'm probably better handing over to Sally to give the respondents view of things.
Dr. Wedger.
Yes, well, I suppose what I would say is that if you don't get the messaging right, the people who are at highest clinical risk and also unpaid carers, then the consequences for this group are more acute than probably any other. Because if people don't have confidence, they won't go out, and they may be very right not to. If they do go out, or they do follow advice that isn't clear, or they haven't understood it, the consequences are very, very serious. And in a way, I've talked about us being, if you like, the canaries in the mine. Because if this is wrong, if it's not got right, it's us that are going to be the people that bear the first brunt of it, the immediate brunt. We are the people that will signal this has not been got right. So it is so important to get this right. And as I say, though, this is now becoming a wider issue because of the wider public risk and the importance of getting that right too, but around long COVID. But, you know, if you don't get it right for people who've got underlying exceptionally high clinical risk, or indeed people with lesser risk, as Professor Pell talked about earlier, then people don't know what to do. They haven't got the information to gauge their own risk. It's all very well to say, well, it depends how much you want to do a thing, but if I don't know what the risk is because I don't know what the locals, the data's not there. We can't gauge our own risk. We can't make a good risk assessment. And neither can GPs a lot of the time either. So that's the problem. It is of critical importance. Other people may be a bit unwell if they get it wrong. Some people may get long COVID. It'll be very much more severe for the likes of us.
Well, I could follow on from that. I think, you know, the because what was right at the start of the pandemic, it evolved and it became wrong. As our knowledge improved, simple things, for example, like initially wearing of a mask was not proven to have any impact until it was proven to have an impact. So how then it's difficult for somebody like me who's not in that category. How difficult is it then for those who are clinically vulnerable to accept that kind of change? And how could government change the way they approach this? You know, the lessons we can learn from this to make the messaging clearer. again, if I've got Dr. Fitch, I'm afraid that sits with you. This question sits with you again, I'm afraid.
Thank you. Well, that's a really easy question, which I can answer in a few minutes, clearly, but or not. But I think the key thing is here, it's about getting the basic communications right, which is, this is an evolving situation, we're learning. It is about the communication of uncertainty, but clarity around that. So people are not being given the message, it's over, and then going, oh no, maybe it isn't after all. Or it is like this, this is our best understanding for now, is different from, it, you know, nobody needs to wear masks. It's about, there's a lot of that that's going on here. It's also though about, I think again, it goes back to sort of talking to the people concerned to find out what their questions are and communicating with them the latest in ways that enable them and giving them the right information, because that I think is the other really big point I've tried to get across here. You know, if you can communicate the wrong information about the wrong initiatives that aren't really going to do the business, like the distance aware scheme, and that isn't going to help. You've got to be clear what it is people need to know. And if you're not clear what they need to know and you're not answering that to start with, I think you're onto a bit of a loser there, frankly. Or indeed, maybe it isn't government that's onto a loser, it's the people at the sharp end that are onto a bit of a loser.
Yeah, I wonder if I can bring...
But I'm happy to come back to you. So I appreciate that as a bit of a quick answer. If you'd like me to come back to you, I'd be very happy to say a bit more on that in writing.
Yeah, I was really hoping you'd solve all our problems in that sort of couple of minutes there. Normally I would. Can I bring Gillian McElroy in on this? It strikes me as that sort of evolving situation would create issues with the organisation that you look after.
Yeah, thank you. I think it also goes back to the topic of trust that we've touched on previously, and building that trust in public health messaging. So I think the starting point, as others have said, is, you know, having that good quality, accessible and inclusive communication as a starting point, and having that at the outset, you know, is a key factor in communicating that public health messaging. But I think I'd also highlight again here the role of the third sector in communicating those messages and helping to build that trust with people that they support. So, you know, third sector and community groups have a key role to play in providing that trusted information and communication. And we saw that through, you know, work to increase vaccine uptake in marginalised communities. And I think similarly, just from an Alliance perspective as well, we have community links workers and GP practices, and we know that they have, you know, been a real key source of support for people throughout the pandemic in providing that advice and support. They have, you know, well established and trusting relationship. And I think it's about, you know, using a wider sort of suite of resources in communicating that sort of public health messaging.
If I can move on we're not hearing much now these days about COVID and the continuing potential risk to certain elements of our society, and we're talking about new normals. We're talking about heading back to, you know, what we used to do pre-pandemic, and not potentially recognising that there are those in society who still are at risk. And I wonder then, you know, what does a new normal really look like for those who are still under risk? Will we require action from a societal issue, societal reaction to that? Will we all have to adjust, or should we all be asked to adjust behaviour in a way to protect those most at risk? I'm going to go to Adam Strucker, because you've been sitting there quietly for a while. I'll go to you first, if I could.
Look, thanks for the tough question, Mr. Whittle. Should we all going forward, okay, let's look back in the early days of this, and those that are most at risk of developing, you know, severe ill health or death as a result of this was very much linked to age, and also different underlying health conditions, which, you know, a lot of this would have come with age. I think what we know from our national helpline and from hundreds of older people's groups across the country, and from 2.5 years of input from over 50s across Scotland to us, is that they were, you know, happy to take up a vaccine and take up multiple vaccines, and there was an anxiety for them. And when there were problems in the administration of it, they were even more anxious, because this was their way in terms of being able to live as they anticipate that they might have otherwise before this pandemic. What does the new normal look like? Well, look, we've got folks who are still going to be shielding or self-shielding because they're worried about the virus, but that's meant that they have not had access to medical treatment, so they might be in poor health as a result of this. I know from a very personal circumstance of this happening, where undiagnosed cancers led to the early death of somebody as a result, but people are really worried about COVID in its sense, but actually the knock-on impact on their lives is going to be quite severe. And we're going to be living with this for a long time. So the new normal for them is going to be much the same, but it's very, very hard. We have the concepts of building back better. What does that mean? Well, there's a lot more in the workplace that we're seeing with regard to kind of flexible working or hybrid working situations. We've also sort of been bounced into in a good way and had to adjust to very quickly. And I think that will be a big positive for people. So where they've got routine responsibilities and other things, that they're kind of their balance in their life might have been better than it otherwise would have. But I'm going to talk in a broader piece of older people in general with that new normal. I think depending on what happens in the future, we've had some, I think, pretty dire warnings from the World Health Organization in recent days about what the future might look like with COVID and how it's a worldwide issue. It's not just amongst the shores of the United Kingdom that we've got to deal with it, that something might come back in a more difficult variant, and that we're going to have to change how we live again. So this hasn't gone. I think there is an anxiety from folks about this. But there's also, almost after 2.5 years, a will from everybody to want to have as much of their freedoms as they had before, to live their lives, because it's been really, really tough going. But having to go back to the point of communication, I'll stop in a second, but go back to communication, has been having enough of that good information from the right sources to people to understand where we are as a country, that demonstrating that when the facts, new facts arise and things change, that can be communicated, that we have new information, this is what we're going to go and do about it, and this is why we want you to understand this, and this is why the thinking behind it. So it's not just, here's the clinical guidance says X, therefore you all must do it. I don't think that really cuts it all the time. You know, we go back to the very beginning of the pandemic where, you know, and we've spoken about this in the past, about the proliferation of do not attempt resuscitation forms landing on people's in a sense, on their mats, where they weren't told this was going to happen, and all of a sudden they're being signed up to such a thing they knew nothing about. There's a sort of a lack of trust in there. So the future is going to look very unpredictable, actually. And I think there's a lot of anxiety from older people about this.
Thank you. And Sally Witcher, would you like to come in?
I think the first thing to say is that whether we like it or not, this is a new normal, it isn't the old one. That does mean change. Some of the change, though, from building on the learning that we've acquired during the pandemic, is actually going to be helpful in creating more inclusion rather than the opposite. And it's about how we build back better, although I've always preferred the phrase build forward better, because I don't want to go back to the old normal. It wasn't that great for disabled people and others. And it's about using all the tools. Now, in some ways, it may be about some changes of behaviour, but not necessarily in bad ways. It's about using the positive learning about, you know, working from home remotely can actually achieve a better life-work balance, and it doesn't mean that people just sit there doing nothing. It can be an incredibly effective way, and because it cuts down on travel time, and it also has implications for climate change. hybrids. You know, there's a real issue now about how we get better hybrid events and so on. But there's, again, that's emerging. Clean air technology. This isn't about people, you know, we've got to get out of this binary way of thinking that, you know, freedom equals restrictions, you know, on, or for, you know, is that kind of what either or the other, or one or the other. It absolutely doesn't have to be that way. You know, what building forwards better should mean is really focusing on what we can do, what everyone can do in order to make this inclusive, safe for everyone. Because that the point is, we could not do that. There's so much that could be done on that. And but if we're going to do it that way, we've got to position that as the vision. We've got to position that as the strategy. And it needs to be wide-ranging. And it's going to need cross-government action. This is the other thing. This isn't just about health. It's about employment, education. It's about hate crime, about community safety. It's about building regulations. It's about, so we need this really comprehensive approach. And it's a mixture of people, you know, accepting on occasions that in order to protect their own freedom, let alone that of everybody else's, they're going to have to behave in certain ways. And it's about maximising the really positive learning and continuing to develop it about how we can make a fully inclusive new normal that is safe and maximises the freedom of everybody. That's what it looks like for me.
And Professor Pell?
So as already raised, I think it's really important that we learn lessons, whether it's dealing with an uptick in COVID or another pandemic in the future. If we look back at how the pandemic started, it was very, and how it was managed at the beginning, it was very different in the UK, Europe and US compared to Asia, because Asia benefited, if you like, from SARS. They were able to have ramp up testing capacity really early on, whereas we were totally reliant on non-pharmaceutical interventions and shielding. So I think there were lessons to learn there. There were some things that we got wrong, and that's inevitable, such as care homes, where we had staff moving between care homes freely. We had residents moving in and out of hospitals and so on. And I think we need to learn from that so that we don't repeat the same mistakes next time. It's not about a witch hunt. It's about just learning from this for the next time that it happens. I think that we need to accept that the new normal includes personal choices and respect those where they don't impact on other people. So just as some people who were asked to shield chose personal freedom, that they wanted to have a high quality short life rather than a very restricted life and so on, and that's entirely their choice if they're not putting other people at risk. But similarly, some people, even though they're no longer on a shielding list, want to keep shielding, and that might be due to real high risk or perceived high risk and just concern about the pandemic, and we have to respect that in terms of how we interact with people and behave towards them. And I do think we need to, as you've said already, incorporate vaccination as being just a normal part of living, vaccination against COVID and boosters.
Thank you. Can I move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you very much, convener. And thanks very much for the panel. I'd like to come to Dr. Witcher, if that's OK. And I know you've been tasked with a lot of the questions this morning. But your article in the Herald this morning, you talked about feeling vulnerable people treated like lepers. That's the headline that's in the paper. And I can absolutely get that feeling of, yeah, it's OK, everybody else is moving on, what about us? Is that your sense of where... I'm trying to not use the word vulnerable because of your previous comments, but the clinically at risk, is that your sense that you're getting left behind?
Very much so, I'm afraid. And just to be clear, I didn't write that article. I would probably have written it a little bit differently. But the point stands. And it was I first made that point in connection to the Distance Aware Scheme, in fact, in as much as... If you think about how lepers previously were treated, I actually went back to the Bible for the first time ever. I consulted the Bible, and it talked about, you know, people being, you know, having to declare themselves, identify themselves, isolated on the outskirts. You know, so there's a, you know, and it was they that had to signal that they were infectious. Now it's the case with the Distance Aware Scheme that that it's the people who don't want to get infected that have to distinguish themselves and have to isolate. Because people who are infected, there's no restrictions on them going out. And frankly, some people are going to have to because they don't have support. They have to work. So, but the reality then means that people become positioned as the people who other people need to kind of, you know, it's us that is that are the ones that are the odd ones out here. It's us that are the outcasts. And I suppose that's kind of in some ways crystallized some of the feeling. Now, that is in the context of the revised strategic framework being very clear about how we must not develop this in such a way that it ends up with people at high clinical risk and other disadvantaged groups being effectively cut off. And I feel, and it isn't just me, if you look at the Twitter thread that was part of the evidence and people's responses, I think it will communicate very powerfully just how people feel about being abandoned, about just not being communicated with, being left behind. And it is about seeing everybody move on and go back. And actually, you know, I think, as I've said before, real worries about their safety too in the current context. But the gap between us and where we're positioned and that of everybody else has become exacerbated. And there have been some examples, you know, and I've seen this for myself as well. As soon as you start pointing out that there's a problem here for people who are at high clinical risk and that you know, this isn't working, you do risk attracting quite a lot of abuse and hostility, which again just underlines you have no place in this society anymore. This new normal doesn't accommodate you. You're not part of it. You are irritating outliers. You are just the people that we ought to kind of remember. You know, so much advice, so much is, messaging is, an oh, and by the way, we ought to remember to protect the vulnerable. We ask people to remember to do this. We're equal citizens. We have equal rights. We're active. You know, vulnerable always conveys passive, helpless, needy. Well, we're only like that because protections have been removed. And we're not asking, you know, we are not demanding lockdown. That's the other thing. As soon as you start saying this, the response you get is, but you're just telling us all to go back into lockdown. No, the point is, we're telling people to do things so nobody has to.
That very comfortable leads me on to where I wanted to take this. My general sense of the whole evidence session we've heard today is that right at the start, everybody got behind it. We all understood it. Everybody was at risk. The message was simple. We started to change it because things were moving, things were evolving. The message became more complicated. It became more difficult to have that one size fits all. So we've got to try and fragment it. You then come into the later stages where you've got competing voices. So hospitality industry want it opened up, we want flights opened up, we want life to go back to normal, we want to get our businesses moving. But in all of that, people then have this, we've got this fatigue now, so we want to get moved on. But you, the clinically vulnerable, sorry, I'm trying to get the right phrasing. The highest risk are stuck. So is there a need for the general public to get a better understanding that the public health message and improving the literacy of people's understanding of what it is that we're actually trying to achieve so that none of us have that feeling that, yeah, okay, everybody else has moved on, but we are still in the same place?
I think the big challenge here is to communicate that actually we're all after the same thing here. None of us are kind of arguing against, you know, everybody locking down. It's not about some people having freedom or not. And it's very much about making the business case. You know, you talk about hospitality industries and travel sector and so on, hotel, whatever, wanting to open up. Well, of course they do. But the point now is, there were ways they could do that to communicate that they are following good practice. They can be installing air filtration. They can be And particularly if it was underlined with some legal backup, and this, as I started talking about at the beginning of this session, COVID safety signage scheme of some kind, which would communicate to people, this is what we've done on COVID safety. It's safe for you to come here, or much safer for you to, because these measures are in place. People just would generally go to a restaurant expecting certain standards to be in place, and that would be inspected. I don't understand, there's a business case for that. People aren't going to go into places which they don't feel safe. So the same as travel. If you don't feel safe, you're not going to travel. And so there's a massive, this is the frustration of it. We're being positioned as it's either this or that. Is this little group over here who are basically kind of getting in the way of everybody kind of getting on with their lives? Well, actually, no, because the sorts of things we're asking for that are going to be of incredible importance to us and incredible impact if they're not there, are of much, much wider benefit. If you put air filters in, air filtration, that removes all kinds of viruses, allergens, pollution, then the general health benefits are going to be widespread. Maybe that's how you protect the NHS. It's rethinking this fundamentally. And trying to get out of the kind of mindset we've got into of the either or, because that's really not where we are now. And of course people have personal choice, and I completely respect that, except where their personal choice causes direct harm to others. And it's very, again, there are plenty of analogies out there seat belts and so on, which people aren't being told not to drive, but they are told they need to pass a driving test and wear seat belts and do certain things on the road.
As Murdo says, you're being heard loud and clear. Does anybody else want to come in on that particular point? Nope. Grand. Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, and I think all members will agree that's been really insightful and informative. So I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you yourselves about how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be on the 30th of June, when we will take evidence from the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport on the inquiry into COVID-19 communication of public health information. We will also consider a negative instrument next week as well. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for this meeting to be moved into private. Thank you.